Merry Christmas! Can you believe it? This time next Sunday, Christmas will be over. But not forgotten. Let's go ahead and stand as we observe the parading of the banner and lighting of the fourth Advent candle as we sing, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee.
Joyful, joyful, we adore thee, God of glory, Lord of love. Hearts unfold like flowers before thee, opening to the sun above. Melt the clouds of sin and sadness, dry the dark of doubt away. Give
Today's scripture is on Luke 1, 46 through 57. And Mary said, My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit has rejoiced in God my Savior.
For he has regarded the lowly state of my maidservant. For behold, henceforth all generations and call me blessed.
For he is mighty and has done great things for me, and holy is his name, and his mercy is on those who fear him from generation to generation.
He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered his proud in the magnificent in the imagination of their hearts.
He has put down the mighty from their thrones and exalted the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty.
He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, and he spoke to our fathers, to Abraham and to his seed forever.
Thank you to the Explorer Sunday School class for the procession today. Thank you all. You can be. Let's pray together. All right. Our Father in heaven, we thank you so much for today and the blessingness of it. We thank you that you did indeed use a common woman. You reached down into her life and blessed her greatly. She didn't deserve it. She was nothing more than a regular human being. But you, Lord, let her be the vessel for your son to come to this world. As we think about this, we're reminded that you're always choosing that which is common, that which is untalented, that which is insignificant, and you love us and you use us. And for that, God, we praise your holy name. Maybe there's someone today who's come here today feeling like they're detached, like they're nobody. Let them know today that you see them, you love them, you know their needs, and you want to work in their life. That today might be the day that they could believe in you, that Jesus Christ died on the cross for their sins and rose from the grave, and that thereby their sins might be forgiven. That this is all possible right here, right now, in these moments. Let them know, Lord, and help each of us as we worship you today to understand how glorious you are. We say these things in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you all, and y'all can be seated. We are glad you're here with us this day. The last Sunday before Christmas. Christmas is a time we as Southern Baptists celebrate. God crossed the universe. God made the biggest crossing possible to reach us with the message of love through His Son. And so we as Southern Baptists like to remember that in the same way as we send missionaries around the world to reach out to spread God's word. And so we take the month of December as you give, that you would be reminded to also give towards missions this month. We have a video to encourage you about God's work around the world.
I kind of see part of my story like Joseph. God brought them out of something that at the beginning of the story makes no sense. Even in the middle of the story, you sometimes wonder, God, what are you doing?
It's an isolated country run by a military government and under civil war for the last 60 years. I had to live in a hotel. We weren't allowed to go very many places. We were even watched and followed sometimes. I was able to get permission to live up there teaching English. So I started having this Bible study. Within a year, we had baptized believers. I knew that's where I was supposed to be. One morning I got to the school, another friend pulls into the compound just frantic. There were investigators. I'd just been kicked out of my country. I felt lost. I knew where my heart wanted to be, but I had to trust that God had a reason, and I have to be okay with not knowing why. I was in a neighboring country. I was in this big city. I went to the market to buy some food. All of a sudden, I hear the language of my people. And I realize there are about 500,000 of them living in my country. They come here just overwhelmed with life in the big city. I felt a lot like they were. I was a refugee. I was in a country I didn't want to be in, but I couldn't go back. Some of them found community in a local church here. And I went to the pastor of that church and asked him, what were the needs here? And after some discussion, he said, what we need is a Bible school in this city. How to share their faith, how to start a church. I don't know how to start a school, but if I need to learn a new skill, I'll learn a new skill. The first day of school, I had 50 students show up. They just kept coming and coming, with little or no sleep, just because they're hungry to learn. And at this point, they're reaching their own people. And they go to a different part of the city to share their faith with factory workers, many of whom have never heard the name of Jesus, show them love, share Christ with them, and plant the gospel seed. Reforms are happening in the country I was banned from. They have new leaders now. I've been granted entry, and I'm making plans to move back again. Looking back on all this, I see that wherever God wants me to be, that's where I feel like I'm home.
So please consider, as you deal with your holiday giving, that you also remember that there are those spreading God's word around the world, and that you pray for them, if possible, that you could give something extra. You can either designate the green envelope for missions for that amount, or there are some envelopes out there on the missions table that are just strictly used for the missions offering. So either way, however you want to do it. We've set a goal of $2,000, and we're already over $1,300, so praise the Lord for that. And we have full confidence we're going to reach that goal. Want to also remind you, we have the Christmas cards out here in our mailbox. Our goal is that if some of your friends or fellow church members that are coming here regularly, you want to get them a Christmas card, we put them in there. And that way the money you save on postage can be used for your missions offering. Please be sure to check that, though, and get your cards, because this Friday, we have our candlelight Christmas Eve service at 6 p.m. So please pick your Christmas cards up by Christmas, okay? But we have our Christmas Eve service this coming Friday evening. It'll be 6 p.m. in here. We should be done by 6:45, so you can get back to your family activities. But we do this every year to have a time of meditation and rejoicing over the birth of our Savior. So come and join us Thursday evening, 6 p.m. The office will be closing Thursday at noon of this week, and also next Thursday it'll be closing early. If you want to get an offering in before the 31st, boy, next Sunday's a real good time for that. If you've got to come by the office or you want to give one late, the last bank deposit we're going to have time to make is going to be on the 29th. So if you can get it here by noon on the 29th of January, when they close up early on Thursday the 30th, there's going to be a lot of last minute things I got to get taken care of. Won't have time to go to the bank. We're not in on Fridays, so you pretty well need to do it by noon on the 29th if you want to get it credited for 2021. If you go online and give it, you can wait right up till midnight on the 31st, though. Okay? So, just so you know about that. Also, Wednesday night this week and Wednesday night next week, there are no activities due to the holidays. And so please keep that in mind. When January rolls around, we are back at regular schedule, regular hours, all that kind of stuff, okay? So please keep all those things in mind. And we do want to remind you, if you're visiting with us for the first time or the first time in a while, we do have our flap here on the bulletin cover. If you wouldn't mind filling that out and dropping it in one of the offering plates around the room, we would greatly appreciate that. Later this morning, after the service, we will be doing the Lord's Supper. So we hope that you'll be prayerful about that. And at this time, we want to just go around and let you know we're glad to see you in the Lord's house today.
As we make it back to our places, and Donna comes running back to the PowerPoint. As we make it back to our places, we will stand as we sing, "How Great Our Joy."
by the sheep we watch at night. Glad tidings brought, an angel bright. How great our joy, great our joy. Joy, 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 joy. Praise we the Lord in heaven on high. Praise we the Lord in heaven on high. There shall the child lie in a stall. There shall the child redeem us all. How great our joy, great our joy. Joy, 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 joy. Praise we the Lord in heaven on high. Praise we the Lord in heaven on high. This gift God we cherish well, that ever joys our heart shall fill. How great our joy, great our joy. Joy, 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 joy. Praise we the Lord in heaven on high. Praise we the Lord in heaven on high.
At this time, the children may be excused to head on up to the children's church. As they head out, the rest of us will sing "It Came Upon a Midnight Clear."
It came upon a midnight clear, that glorious song of old, from angels bending near the earth to touch their harps of gold. Peace on the earth, goodwill to men, from heaven's all gracious King. The world in solemn stillness lay to hear the angels sing. For lo, the days are hastening on, by prophets said of old, when with the ever-circling shall come the time foretold, when the new heaven and earth shall own the Prince of Peace, their King. And the whole world send back the song which now the angels sing.
Come to that time in our service, our prayer time, where we lift our hearts up to God, we confess our sins, we tell Him what's troubling us, what we're struggling with, what we're afraid of, what's overwhelming us, the people in our life that need Him so desperately. So we invite you, the altar is open. Maybe today, as it's the Lord's Supper, that you might want to take extra time to come and speak with God about the state of your soul, and how you stand in His eyes, and how this year has been for you. It is time for us to come before the Lord, to speak with Him, and to share it all. The altar is open if you wish to come up here. One of our deacons, Ralph Carriaga, will pray with you if you want someone to pray with you. So let's bow our heads, and let's talk with the Lord. Thank you. Emmanuel, God with us. Jehovah Jireh, the Lord will provide. Jesus, Jehovah will save us. All these names for you, Lord, and so many more, the Lamb of God, the Lion of Judah. You are our Savior, the one who left his heavenly throne to come into a filthy old barn, to lay in a food trough, to save sinners. You left glory to walk among failures, to walk among evildoers, criminals, to walk among those who are hateful, those who are hopeless. And yet to each and every one of them, because you walked among them, you gave them hope. You told them there has come a balm from Zion. Something to heal us, something to cleanse us, something to save us. Someone who could make all things right, and it was you. And you were nailed to a cross for it, but you rose from the grave on the third day. It all began in that manger. It all began in eternity when you, Lord, decided there will be a way for men to be my children. From the foundations of the earth, you were the Lamb that was slain. We praise you for this because all of these things show us just how much you loved us. None of it was an accident. Every bit of it, you decided that you wanted us. You decided that you loved us. As big of failures, as disobedient, as whatever we heap the blame upon ourselves for being, Lord, you saw past it all. And when you cleanse us, and when your Holy Spirit moves in, we are new creations. We are new people. In that moment that we ask Christ to save us, everything changes. We have gone from condemned to blessed. We have gone from outcast to adopted. What a great Christmas this is. When we stop and think what you really gave us. How can we be depressed? How can we be discouraged? How can we be defeated when you have done all these things for us? Christmas is a time of rejoicing because it was the first visible step in your plan that we could actually see. Oh Lord, thank you for Jesus. Help us today. Help us, those of us who've lost the joy, who've lost sight, who in our old age, we've gone through this too many times, too many Christmases, too many family conflicts, too many bills to pay, and we get discouraged and it becomes dull to us. Lord, forgive us. Let us recapture the wonder that Mary must have felt as she pondered all these things in her heart as she looked upon her baby. Remind us what it must have been like for shepherds out there to suddenly be confronted with a heavenly host, a heavenly choir singing to them that there was a Savior for them. God, remind us, let the story never be old. Let it never be dull. Ignite in our hearts a fire, a passion to remind us what a wonderful Savior you are, Jesus. Thank you for coming like you did. And we say all these things in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Join with me in singing "Good Christian Men Rejoice."
Good Christian men rejoice with heart and soul and voice. Give heed to what we say. Jesus Christ is born today. Ox and ass before him bow, and he is in the manger now.
is born today. Good Christian men, rejoice with heart and soul and voice. Now the year of endless bliss, Jesus Christ was born for this.
Let's go ahead and stand for our offertory, and if you haven't dropped your offering envelopes or your communication cards in the offering plates, please feel free to do that as we sing Joy to the World.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth rejoice. And heaven and nature sing. No more let sin and sorrows grow, nor thorns infest the ground. He comes to make his blessings flow, for as the curse is found, far as the curse is found, far as the curse is found. Here rose the world with truth and grace, and makes the nations rough. The glories of his righteousness and wonders of his love. And wonders of his love, and wonders of his love.
Father God, we just thank you, Lord, for this time of season when we celebrate the coming of your Son, God born of flesh, to dwell among men. We thank you for the example that he lived, that sinless life. We thank you for his death upon the cross, the carrying of our sins, and his resurrection to give us life eternal with you, Lord. May we never forget the love that you have for us, the blessings that you bestow upon us, and the life that you give us eternally with you, Lord. We thank you for this time that we have to give back, and we ask, Lord, that you just take and multiply our whatever tithes and offerings we bring, Lord, that we not only can reach this community around us, but that we can reach the world. And I pray, Lord, that you just continue to guide us and protect us and forgive us when we sin against you. For it's in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. All right, if you have your Bibles with you, we're going to be in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 1. Gospel of Luke, chapter 1, verses 26 through 38. Now, I know we talked about Mary earlier this month, and that's okay. We're going to talk about her a little bit again today. And maybe even a bit of a rant from me, I guess. I don't know. I'm trying not to. But the passage today, And stopping to think of what goes on in the world around us and how people try to find just about any excuse they can to run down the Lord and what he's trying to do with us and through us in Jesus Christ. We're going to read Luke chapter 1, verses 26 through 38.
Luke chapter 1, verse 26. Would you stand, please, for the reading of God's word? Luke chapter 1, verse 26. Now in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And having come in, the angel said to her, "Rejoice, highly favored one. The Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women." But when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, and considered what manner of greeting this was. Then the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. He will be great, and will be called the Son of the Highest, and the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Then Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I do not know a man?" And the angel answered and said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Highest will overshadow you. Therefore also that Holy One who is to be born will be called the Son of God. Now indeed, Elizabeth, your relative, also has conceived a son in her old age. And this is now the sixth month for her who was called barren. For with God, nothing will be impossible." Then Mary said, "Behold, the maidservant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." And the angel departed from her. Father in heaven, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the comfort it brings, the joy it stirs within us. We thank you for Jesus, and it's in his name we say it. Amen. Thank you, and you can be seated. Entitled the sermon, "Mary, You Did Know." I did that mainly to avoid copyright conflicts. About 30 years ago, there was a brand new Christian song called "Mary, Did You Know?" We've sang it here in this church, and you've heard it probably every time, every Christmas. And I think it's a wonderful song. The singer is asking Mary, "Did you realize that when you kissed your baby, you were kissing the face of God? That the baby you delivered would one day deliver you? That your baby would walk on water and such things? Did you know that?" And it's not in the sense of, "Mary, were you some kind of a fool that didn't realize this?" The song is asking in the sense of, you know, if we ran into Mary in heaven, wouldn't you want to say to her, "Mary, what all did you know? Did you realize all that? What was it like? That is just amazing that you held that child in your arms, that you bore him in your womb." To me, it's a song of fascination and wonder of what it must have been like to be the mother that bore Jesus Christ. But of course, there are those parts in our society that just gotta criticize something. And there are those that say, "Oh, the song is condescending towards women, like Mary wasn't smart enough to know." We know she was smart enough. She did know. There are others who say it's just another example of men trying to hold women down and mansplain to her what was really happening. Mary knew it all, as we see in this passage. Why? Because when God uses one of his children, he communicates to them everything they need to know. Now, we wish sometimes he'd tell us a little bit more, but he always tells us enough. And so when we look at Mary's story, I think it's a fascinating thing, because we are all in the danger, because here come the holidays. Those of us who are old enough, man, it happens every year till we're almost tired of it. And I think we get tired of it, we get stressed by it, we get caught up in all the peripheral issues, and most of all, we lose the sense of wonder of what must have been lying in that manger that night. The sense of amazement to be standing there and told by an angel, "You're going to bear a child, and he is going to be called the Son of the Highest." We've heard it so often, we're just kind of, yeah. Many families, we have the tradition of reading the Christmas story before we open the presents. And we do that because we always want to be reminded what this whole thing is about, and that we always stay a little bit amazed. What a wondrous thing. I mean, we sit there and we ponder and ponder, how does Santa Claus get down every chimney? How does he get into houses that don't have chimneys?
we ponder how he hits 7 billion people in the world in one 24-hour period. Well, we've got the international dateline, so maybe that figures into it. But we put all that wonder into that, and we realize, are the children all upstairs? Okay, that story's not all that true, okay? But this one about Jesus is God's holy truth to us. And it's even more amazing when you consider that the creator of the world left his throne to live in the filth that is our life, the sin that dwells around us. And Mary is amazed. You remember when we read the passage in Luke chapter 2 where the shepherds have come and they have rejoiced at seeing the child and they all leave. And then at the end of that little episode, it says, and Mary pondered all these things in her heart. What it must have been like to see and to hear and to know all of these things. What did Mary know in all of this? Well, one thing I think we can all agree is Mary knew in these moments God's grace. Look at verse 28. The angel came in and said to her, rejoice, highly favored one. Rejoice, highly favored one. Now that sounds good. When we look at it in English, and most English translations say something like, highly favored one. What the language there in the original tells us is that favored means basically dunked in grace. It is a word that could almost be translated grace-filled. It is a word that means, man, God's grace is just all over you, lady. It's not that just that you're the lucky winner of the raffle, you get to win the privilege of bearing Jesus. No, it is you have been soaked, dunked, inundated with God's grace. And you may say, that's good for her. If you ever get a chance to read the book of Ephesians, over in chapter 1, verse 6, it says, we are saved to the praise of the glory of His grace. And listen to this, by which the Lord made us acceptable in the Beloved. That phrase, God made us acceptable, over in Ephesians 1, 6, is the same phrase here, highly favored, here in Luke chapter 1. What are we saying? Once again, God made us acceptable. God made us redeemable. God made us His. And that's what He's telling Mary. You've been made acceptable, O highly favored one. You are, O acceptable one. You are the one that has been cleansed. You have been filled and dunked and bathed in God's grace. And the blessed thing is, because we read the same phrase over in Ephesians 1, 6, so have I and so have you, you who believe. But Mary was a saint. Look, that same grace she got, you get. That same grace that made her special in God's eyes makes you special in God's eyes. You may say, He's never wreaked a great miracle like that through me. No, He has not, but maybe He's done other things through you. Other miracles you may not be aware of. Other ways He's worked through you. Other ways you don't realize because it's all His grace and not your ability. She was a young lady, and after that, her qualifications ended. God's grace took over. You and I may wonder if we're useful, if we're valuable, why God would want us, and yet He makes us acceptable. He dunks us in His grace. He pours it out upon us. In a little while, we'll celebrate the Lord's Supper. What do we do at the Lord's Supper? We take that bread, and we remember how Christ's body was broken for us. We take that cup and we remember how His blood and His life were poured out for us. And in so doing, we remember what a glorious thing it means to be one of God's children. Because see, giving us His grace wasn't like, okay, here's some grace dust, let me sprinkle it on you. No, that grace cost us. Mary would have to raise her child knowing that there would come a day when he would be arrested, he would be carried away, and he would be executed upon that cross. In fact, when her and Joseph went to dedicate Jesus in the temple, Simeon came up to them, and God had promised Simeon, you're not going to see death until you see the Messiah. And there he was. And Simeon said to them, man, this child's going to be for the rising and falling of many. And then looks at Mary and says, and a sword shall pierce your own heart also. She had the agony of being before that cross and watching her child die. In that moment, she probably didn't feel too highly favored. But God's grace carries us through moments like that. Through death, through agony, through all of it. God's grace will go with us, that favor, that making us acceptable. It will not be removed from us no matter what evil, terrible, horrible trials we're going through. In verse 47, we read during the scripture reading, Mary said, my spirit has rejoiced in God my Savior. He has regarded the lowly state of his maidservant, and behold, henceforth all generations shall call me blessed. What is she saying? Wow, I found God's grace. I'm just a common girl. But from here on out, people are going to call me blessed. Not because I'm a special saint. But I think, you know, it must have been blessed to be Peter to at least walk a few steps on the water. It must have been blessed to be John who got to see heaven and write about it in the book of Revelation. It must have been wonderful to be all those who watched Jesus feed a multitude, calm a storm, heal a child dying. That grace going out to all of us. And Mary says, that grace came to me. My spirit rejoices in God my Savior. This Christmas, did the Lord come to you? Find rejoicing in that. Whatever else is weighing you down, remember God's grace has come to you. Something else Mary knew besides God's grace was Mary knew Jesus' identity. You know, that was one of the criticisms of that song, Mary, Did You Know? How did she not know his identity? Why is the song asking such a silly question? But again, the song asks the questions in terms of, that must have been amazing that you knew, that you understood, that you pondered in your heart. Those of us who have had a child, through the pregnancy, through their early childhood, weren't you wondering what this child was going to become? Weren't you wondering and praying that God would do something wonderful with them? As you look on them every day and as they grow, does part of your mind wonder, where will this child be? And now you look maybe at your grandkids, even great-grandkids. Can you imagine Mary looking at hers every day? He's going to walk on water. He's going to heal the blind man. He's going to raise the dead. He's going to bring life to everyone. And God let him grow up in my house. How can this be? What a wondrous thing it is. We look over in chapter 1, verse 51. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. He has put down the mighty from their thrones. These are the great works of Christ, that as evil rises up against him, Christ will put them down. In verse 53, he has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he sent away empty. That this picture here is of a Messiah who would come and help the weak, help the helpless, lift up the fallen. And those, the rich, the powerful who had trod them down, he would overcome them and leave them empty-handed. This is the baby Mary held in her arms. She knew the identity of Jesus. We look at verse 31. You will bring forth a son and call his name Jesus. When Joseph was told, call his name Jesus, what was Joseph told? He shall save his people from their sins. That's what the name of Jesus means. So she knows he's going to save his people from his sins. She knows in verse 32, he will be great and will be called the Son of the Highest. That phrase, Son of the Highest, the word great, you know, I mean, we all hope our kids grow up to be great. That they grow up to be someone who can take care of their parents in their old age, rich enough to do that. And that they would be respectable people, that they would have successful, joyful lives. We all want that. But when they say to her, your son will be great, they're using the word literally transliterated into mega. Your son is going to be mega. Your son is going to be awesome, great, fabulous. Not just a rich guy, not a political leader. He is going to be the Son of the Highest. He is going to be God among us, Emmanuel. and the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. See, here's your son's destiny. The throne of David is not just getting to be the leader of Israel. The throne of David is God's ultimate throne, the one that would rule all nations. And though it's called David's throne, David's not going to sit in it. Jesus is. She knew who her son was going to be. Yes, he made him crazy sometimes. Remember that time? They were in Jerusalem during the Passover. And it was time to leave town, and they took off. And they were out of town for a while before they noticed Jesus being gone. Because Mary and Joseph did the thing of, well, I thought he was with you. Well, I thought he was with you. And they got to turn back around about a day or two's journey and get back into Jerusalem. And they finally find him. They found him with the teachers in the temple. And what did Jesus say to his parents when they found him? Did you not know I'd be about my father's business? Yeah, we knew, but we didn't think about it like that because we went into panic state when you were missing, just like a ravaged parent would do. But it makes sense now. They knew who he was. They knew that he was about his father's business. They knew his path would ultimately lead to Calvary. And then Mary also knew something. That as she's being given this prophecy, she's being told something. You're going to be pregnant here shortly. And you will remember, we know the story of Joseph. He's all upset. It looks like his girlfriend's pregnant. He's got to do something. He doesn't want to hurt her. He doesn't want to shame her. But that baby's not his. And then the angel appears to Joseph to tell him, don't be afraid. This is God's child. And then here is Mary, wondering, how's this going to look to everybody? I got a boyfriend and it's not his. She's wondering Joseph's going to react exactly the way he did. But what does Mary find out? Mary finds out about God's reliability. Verse 34, Mary said to the angel, how can this be? I can't do this. There's no way. I have not known a man. How can I have a baby? Verse 35, the angel said, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the highest will overshadow you. And he goes on telling her all of these things, that the Holy One who is born will be called the Son of God. And he closes it all up with, for with God nothing shall be impossible. Amen. Well, she just learned how reliable God is. What is her response to that? Okay. Behold, the maidservant of the Lord. Mary's response is such that, wow, okay, you've got all the bases covered. I am not going to have a troubled pregnancy. I have not been a bad girl. I am not going to be shamed. The Holy Spirit is going to come upon me, and I am going to carry his seed, and he will be called the Son of the Highest. And my cousin Elizabeth, who's way too old to have a baby, is in her 6th month right now. In fact, that's where Mary's going next. But to remind us that God is in control and nothing is impossible. She's learned you can trust God. He's going to come through in the craziest situations. When we jump over to verse 54... He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy as he spoke to our fathers, to Abraham, and to his seed forever. This passage we read for our scripture reading this morning that the ladies did for us, verses 46 through 55, is called the Magnificat. It is Mary's song that she bursts out in after hearing the wonderful news that God is going to use her. And in this song, she shares further what she knows, that it's not just God is going to see her through this. God has been planning this for a while. He helped his servant Israel, and in remembrance of his mercy, he's keeping the promise to Abraham that through you, Abraham, through your seed, all nations will be blessed. Tiny little verse in the Old Testament, but man, here it comes in Jesus. Everyone can come to him. God can be trusted to follow through with everything. And then Mary knew and embraced her calling. After visiting with this angel, Mary's on board with God's plan. She starts out scared to death, as you can imagine.
She passes into confusion. How is this going to happen? I've never known a man. But when it's all said and done, when God has revealed the work to her, she says in verse 58, "Behold, the maidservant of the Lord." That's another way of saying, "I am yours, Lord. I am your servant, your slave, to do your will as you wish. Let it be to me according to your word." See, another thing this song drove up was some of the people out there really got upset because it looks like God's just forcing his will on an unwilling Mary. Well, there in verse 58, or 38 rather, Mary says, "Okay, let it be. I am the maidservant. I am your servant, Lord. Do what you will." That's not being forced upon. That's consent. She's a willing player here now that she understands what God is doing. She realizes she's not worthy, but she has been dunked in grace. She has found favor. She is understanding everything that God wants to do. She doesn't know how, but she knows he's reliable. He can be trusted. So she submits. She obeys her calling. She embraces it. Sometimes when you first find out you're with child, I'm sure you're scared. You're frightened. How are we going to do it? If you've already got children, how are we going to afford another one? But then it starts to settle in, that child is going to be someone that needs your love and your guidance. That child is someone that is yours and a gift from God. And in all of that, we embrace that pregnancy. With all its morning sickness, with all its cramps, with all its issues, we embrace it. And here comes Mary, saying to this incredible opportunity from God, "Behold, I am your servant. Let it be to me according to your word." This ultimately is the message of Christmas. What if you and I, commoners like Mary, commoners like the shepherds, just say, "Lord, let it be for us." Why were the shepherds the ones the angels sang to? They were just a bunch of guys doing their job. But God thought they were worth it. The three wise men, however many there were, the Bible really doesn't say, they came from afar. Why did God choose them? I don't know. But he made sure that even people outside among the unknown nations had a place in the life of Christ, had a piece of that gospel for them also. In the same way, he looks down at commoners like us and says, "This is for us." Remember Pastor David's favorite part of the Christmas story. Today is born to you a Savior. To you, to me, a Savior's been born. Can we be like Mary and embrace that? As incredible as it is that this child would grow up committing no sin, this child was our Creator. This child was there at the very beginning. This child would calm storms and rule over nature, rule over sickness and disease, rule over the spirit world, and rule over even death. And then this child would die on that cross and rise from the grave on the third day. A body that was broken, blood that was poured out, and yet he rose again. Mary knows, do you? Do you know that this story of Jesus can change your life also? That this Christmas story is just the beginning of where it's all headed. And for each one of us to know that God communicated this to us, that he would be the Son of the Highest. You would call his name Jesus because he'll save his people from his sins. You'll call his name Emmanuel because God is with us. Whatever your state right now, no matter how hard it's been, he has come down to reach out to you where you're at. Here he is today. Is Christmas still boring to you? Can we stop and realize what it must mean that the Lord left heaven to take you back up there? And that's available for you. Am I good enough, though? That's the message of the whole thing.
Have you found favor? Have you been made acceptable? Have you believed? It's not about getting yourself acceptable. The only thing that made you acceptable and favorable is you believed. Right now that he died for your sins and rose from the grave. That is what makes the difference. At this Christmas and every Christmas. We're going to pray here in a moment. Give you an opportunity if you want to act upon this. We're going to celebrate the Lord's Supper, and that is only for those believers in Christ who have been baptized. But we want you to take that first step today, so as you are here with us, it'll mean a little bit more when you realize, yes, that body was broken for me. That blood was poured for me. We're going to have a prayer, and then we're going to sing a couple stanzas of a song. And during that time, if you want to come and have me pray with you, I'm going to invite you to do so, okay? So let's all bow our heads and let's get ready to pray. Father in heaven, so good to know you love us like you do. So wonderful to know you would not hold back anything to reach out for us. To know that you loved us like this. So Lord, today as we worship you, and as we remember you, we pray that you're opening up the eyes and the hearts of those worshiping with us today, that they might come to know you as Savior. That if there's anyone here who's never known Christ, today could be the day. Remind us, Lord, that Mary was a human being just like the rest of us. She committed her sins, she had other children, but in those moments, Lord, she was your vessel. Open and obedient, just like we hope we are. So we say all these things in the name of the Father, Son, and Spirit. Amen. We're going to stand and we're going to sing a couple stanzas of the song. If you would like to take a step forward in your faith, I invite you to come and let me pray with you about it, all right? So let's all sing. What are we singing? I surrender all. As we sing, you're invited to come.
All to Jesus I surrender.
Make their way to the tables. You will notice we have two tables up here in the front and there's two tables in the back with white tablecloths on them. On those tables are the bread and the cups. What we ask is that you in an orderly fashion make your way to the center aisle, depending on whether you're closer to the front or the back as to which where you would go. But if you would go to the center aisle, and when it's your turn, the deacon will hand you the bread. They will pick it up with tongs placed in your hand. You can pick up a cup and then go around the outside aisle to make it back to your seat, please. We'll keep it in an orderly fashion like that. Do your best to stay 5-6 feet apart if you can during this time period, okay? And so that's how we do the Lord's Supper. Again, as we see in the Word of God, the Lord's Supper was directed towards believers, those who have believed in the Lord Jesus Christ and been baptized. And so we ask that you respect that. If you, for whatever reason, choose not to participate in the Lord's Supper, that is between you and the Lord, and we respect that. What we ask is that you simply do take the opportunity to remember what God has done for you, to remember what Christ has done. We do not see any miracle happening here. We simply see that the bread represents his body broken, the cup represents his blood poured out for us, and if we will simply remember all that broken body and the sacrifice of that blood, that is what God commands of us, to worship him on this day and to remember what Christ has done. All right, so we are going to have a word of prayer to bless the elements, and then you may make your way out into the aisles and get your elements, all right? Let's bow our heads together. Thank you, Father. You are so good. That you who would not withhold your old son would not withhold any good thing from us. You gave him to us without hesitation. Jesus, you came, and even though you wrestled within on that night in Gethsemane, you drank the cup that your father gave you. You stomped the head of the serpent who had bruised your heel. You've defeated death in the grave, and we need no longer fear death because of you. So today we take a moment, not only as we remember your birth, but we remember your death. And what a glorious thing it is. We know in your word you never commanded us to remember your birth, but you do command us to show forth the Lord's death until he comes. So today we shall. We remember you, Lord. Thank you for giving it all for us. We say these things in the name of the Father, Son, and Spirit. Amen. So if you'd come. Who has believed our report? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of dry ground. He has no form or comeliness, and when we see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we did not esteem him. Surely he has borne our griefs and our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. And the chastisement for our peace was upon him. And by his stripes, we are healed. The night he was betrayed, Jesus took the bread and said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Take and eat this in remembrance of me." The same night he was betrayed, he took the cup. And he said, "This cup is my blood, in which is written the new covenant. Take and drink this as often as you drink this in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death until he comes." Todd Lansford, would you come and dismiss us, please? Want you to remember this coming Thursday night, 6 p.m., or Friday night, 6 p.m. will be the Christmas Eve service in here. It'll be by candlelight, so you are invited, and we hope you have a Merry Christmas. Todd?
Everybody stand, please. I know this is kind of a thing, but Mary knew, but don't you have questions? Like, was it a hard pregnancy? Was it an easy pregnancy? All the women know how that is, most of them. just one of those things that kind of pondered, flipped into my mind back there when we were listening to this, like, I wonder if it was a hard because everybody has difference. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you today. We thank you for Mary and for her willingness to take the calling and the Lord picking her because he knew that he had favor with her. We thank you for Jesus, Lord, as we come this time to celebrate his birth and for the saving grace that he has provided to every one of us. For with him, we are nothing. We just want to praise him for that. We want to be thankful for that. We want to be gracious. We want to be humble when we come before him. Show him the grace and the mercy and the forgiving that he has given to all of us. And just for watching out over us. Just go with us at this time that we can spread his good news to those that are around us. The ones that we're in contact with every day. That they can know that we are a child of the Most High. Just watch over us, be with us this week, and just be with those that are traveling all around to see families. Let them celebrate you, Lord. Let them celebrate your birth and celebrate families and how he had planned it. Forgive us where we fail you, Heavenly Father, in Jesus' name, amen.